So now we're about to smash our boat into the rocks. So before this adventure has even begun, it's probably over. Things to learn, and that 100 hours I can honestly say is that I learned the most out of this whole thing during that 100 hours. The boat builders are also the guys that are training us, and he's the current world record holder for the four-man team that he did last year. And so he said, look, this is one on the east coast, we're in Essex, on the east coast of the UK, and he said, you're gonna go north. We started Burnham on Crouch, which, imagine the heel of England, it's right at the heel of England, and you're going to go north in the North Sea. You can be, if you want to lose shore, you can, but you're going to basically stay, I mean, you don't want to go to, you know, Norway or anything like that, and hug the coast up, but whatever you do, do not pass a place called Great Yarmouth. They're like, winds are pretty aggressive, so please be aware. And I was like, look, I think we're going to do this like in a day or two. And he's like, no, it's going to take you 2-3 days, like minimum 2-3 days. You'll be. All right. So we head out and we navigate out of very tricky. It's extremely tricky because the North Sea, and I didn't realize that. I thought the North Sea is like, whoa, it's like compared to the Atlantic, it's a piece of cake. Not at all. The North Sea is a tumultuous sea. It's extremely shallow. You have winds coming from the Atlantic and the channel in the English Channel, and they come out aggressively into the North Sea. So it's a shallow sea that has high winds. So the waves can be really erratic and they can white cap, they can crash. And at the same time, it's tidal. So when you have a tide going in one direction, and we learned that, and the wind going in the other direction, the type of waves it does is really aggressive, short, sharp waves. Dah, you know, from every direction. So the boat is rocking like this, you know, and you can't predict, and there's no rhythm. It's not like you can just get into a rhythm. The Atlantic is big, massive swells, huge, 10 times bigger than the waves we were in. Like 20 meters high waves, but you know, a completely different ball game. And because it's shallow, the North Sea, you have to be careful not to ground because it's tidal. So all of a sudden a sandbar pops up and you're rowing. And so you gotta be awake, you gotta be, and the Brits decided they want to put wind turbines inside the water. And I'm like, guys, I mean, and I'm sure, you know, they weren't really thinking about two guys rowing. It doesn't really matter to them doing energy, making energy, whatever. But high inconvenience for us, okay? High inconvenience for us. Because here we are now slaloming between turbines. So the idea is when you have the wind and the tide with you, everything is pushing you north. If you have a tide against you, the wind was strong enough that you were still getting a little bit of a push, but it almost canceled out, so you could still row. But if you had the wind against you, it was sort of game over. And we were flying. We're talking like 6-7 knots an hour, and we're rowing, and the sickness began, right? Omar got it pretty bad on the first day, and he was super dehydrated. We were really concerned for a while because it was just continuous. It was no reprieve, you know. But he managed it like a champ. He hung in there. I had a stomach issue that I had brought on from shore. So now I had to use the toilet, which is a bucket. Okay, a bucket, but we're fancy, so we got a bucket with a seat. And the thing is, you get this bucket, and I want you to picture this, and now you have three layers of clothes, and how do you even, like, how, I'm like, oh, I don't, okay, well, I need to peel this, and I gotta figure this out, and the boat is going like this, and the bucket is going, so you're trying to hold on to the bucket with your, and like, it's just, it was a bit of a nightmare situation, and there's another guy on the boat, right, but thankfully he was sick enough that he was sleeping inside, so he's not watching me do this circus, right, and I'm bouncing everything, and you miss, and it's like, no, guys, it is quite an adventure, and then, you know, finally, the first time I did it, I clean up, and we're in the middle of the sea. There's nothing around us. And Omar is sleeping. And after I finished all of this, and I sit back and I'm like, oh my God, like this is finally over, right? I look to my left and a boat had pulled up to say hello and witnessed the entire thing happen. So literally I was like, hello. Needless to say, they didn't talk to us. They kept on going. So I had that situation. I had that whole stomach situation. He had the seasickness. And we were ill prepared. We didn't have seasickness tablets. We didn't have a lot of different things. We only had one pair of pants that were waterproof. So one of us is going to get wet. It, like little things like that. But the beauty about it is when it was Omar's shift, even if he couldn't row, and even though he looked like a shell of a human being, he came out every time and said, Omar, go rest, you need to rest. I'm like, it's okay, I'll row some more, you need to get over this, just keep up. No. And he would put his rain and wind gear and tie himself to the boat, life jacket, and rough it out in the middle of the night, just hanging on, just so that I could rest, you know. And so he took care of me that way, and then when he would be sleeping, I would try not to wake him up, like let him sleep a little bit more. And he did the same thing. So it's, we took care of each other. And that was really, really cool. Like really like nice to know that like we got each other's back and whatnot. The first 36 hours were absolute hell. And at 3 a.m., I'm in a shipping lane and there's massive ships coming through and Omar's sleeping and everything is fine. I'm rowing. And when you're rowing, it's not like the concept two, nice, perfect strokes. No. You go to row and you miss everything and hits your chins and you're bleeding down your chin and you get air and you're doing one armed. And it's going like this, left, right, and this and that. And it's raining and it's windy and the waves were actually crashing. One of my favorite things is, when the waves were crashing, I was able to make some sense out of them. And I found like that if you did like little stroke, and then big stroke, right before the peak, you could surf them and you lean back on the boat and literally your speed goes up to like 10 knots and you're like, oh my God. Like that was my favorite thing. At 3 a.m. and then like in all of this mayhem, the boat, we have a GPS that's linked to an autopilot, and you essentially put where you want to go, the waypoint where you want to go, and it controls the rudder. So you literally just have to row. All of a sudden, the boat is starting to go towards shore. And I'm like, what's going on? And the autopilot broke. So where I'm sitting there, it's 3 a.m. and I don't know what's going on. I stopped rowing. I'm in the back hatch. I'm on my knees and I'm trying to figure out this piece of equipment that I played with, but not that much. And I'm upside down and it's dark and I'm using my light. And all of a sudden, because I'm upside down and it's dark and in that little thing, then all of a sudden, oh my God, I feel sick. So then I get sick and I'm holding on to the rudder at the same time as I'm sick, because I figured that there was a lighthouse, and if you lined up the lighthouse with a certain part on the boat, then you're going in the right direction. So I gotta make sure that we're going in the right direction, because I don't want to go in the wrong direction, and I'm sick and ruddering, and it was just like craziness. And finally, I figure out how to like replace it. And so the autopilot is a crucial piece of equipment, because it saves you a lot of headache. And so we bought five. We're like, we're not taking any risk. Like one breaks out, switch. And replaced it, we're back to normal. So great. 6 hours later, that one goes. But this time it was a different issue. I think it was our GPS or whatever. So it was like, we had technical difficulties, we had physical difficulties, we had really rough conditions. We had it all in the span of 36 hours. So we reached Great Yarmouth super quick, super quick. In 36 hours, we were there. So we had to pull over in Great Yarmouth. And secondly, we couldn't row in the middle of the night anymore because the autopilots are dead, which means that we had to hand steer. And because there's so many obstacles and things, that means you're not resting. So you're either rowing or hand steering. You're rowing or hand steering, which means that you literally are not going to sleep all night. So at some point, you're going to break. So we were like, okay, we actually have to sleep the nights now and then hand steer during the day. And no breaks during the day, basically. You're constantly exposed to the elements. Great Yarmouth, we were looking at the maps and we misunderstood them and ended up in a industrial harbor that's just on the backside of it. But which meant that in order for you to get back to the harbor, you had to go against the wind and against the tide, which we're like, let's give it a shot. We gave it a shot. Next thing you know, poof, we're getting blown north, which we're not supposed to do. And we're like, oh my God, what do we do? It's too deep to anchor. Let's emergency anchor. We don't even know what we're doing. We're tying the anchor and it's too deep. We're like, it doesn't matter because we're heading straight for wind turbines. So we throw the anchor and the boat slows down. We're like, oh my God, yes. And it stops. And literally it's like 200 meters from the wind turbines. And we're waiting for the tide to shift. And we were so happy that we did this, and we celebrated, right? And we looked, and we kept on always looking to make sure we're not dragging our anchor. And eventually, the tide turned, and we decided to go back, and we went back into this beautiful, as soon as we entered, calm, perfect, still water. The sky, the sun was setting, and the sky, there was rain on one side and darkness and then light on the other and a rainbow, two full double rainbows as we're entering into the harbor, into this quaint British town that somebody literally drew. And we're like, oh my God, like this is like, have we died and gone to heaven? Like, this is amazing. Like, I can tell you that during this trip, we've seen the worst lows, the absolute worst lows and the most amazing highs. Anyway, so we ended up spending the night in Great Yarmouth and then trying to fight our way back down to Burnham on Crouch. Didn't really make it because the conditions were pushing us in the wrong direction. So we had to go back to Great Yarmouth. But this time we knew not to make the same mistake, right? We know exactly how to enter. As we're entering into the harbor and we're coming close, and this is one of the biggest learning experience of how we deal with emergencies. We're getting really, really close. So what? Imagine this, it's a massive harbor and this is the entrance of the harbor. And you have to come, you curl and you have to come into the harbor. Here is all rocks. And then the harbor wall and massive ships, guys. I'm talking about like when we tie our boat to the side of the harbor, you have to climb a 10 meter ladder. Like it's like industrial, you know, like pretty rough. And Omar is rowing and I'm steering and we're perfect. We're coming right in. We're pretty relaxed about it. And all of a sudden just the conditions shift and we're not moving. We're just stuck and Omar is rowing, but we're just stuck. And it's the entrance of a massive harbor. And we're just sitting there. And then you can see the harbor master is like right above us, watching the whole thing unfold. Boom, boom, boom. One thing leads to another. Wind shifts. Boom, the boat starts to shift into the rocks. So now we're about to smash our boat into the rocks. So before this adventure even began, it's probably over. And we're like, and you know, as you'd expect me, I'm pretty like vocal. So I'm seeing all of this and I'm like, very vocal. I'm like, Omar, harder, row harder. Like you have to row harder. You know, and I'm like, and I'm like, you can do it. And like a very like intense. And Omar is like, stop telling me to row harder because I'm rowing as hard as I can. There's nothing left. I'm like, this is not for you. It's for me. I need to talk. Right. And just, yeah, it was pretty incredible. And he did this for like 20, 30 minutes. He fought. And held us in place. And then we did a very, very, the fastest switch we've ever done because he's getting tired.
Everything was great. We're doing an average of 5 knots getting into Great Yarmouth to finish our little journey. And then the weather just switched to wind and everything just before the mouth of the harbor. And we just almost hit the rocks, we almost lost our boat. And then we got pushed out again to where we had anchored before. And now the winds have picked up to like I said, like 20 knots or something. And it's looking like it's going to sustain like that till Tuesday, which is like 3 days from now. Which is bad news. Yeah, that's what's going on. I'm going to try to go get that rope out. It's going to be fun.
But this time actually, there was no way out because the wind was up to 20 knots and it was going to pick up to 50 knots over the next 3 days with no reprieve. So there's no way we'd ever be able to row back. Impossible, ever. So we called the Coast Guards, which was, that was amazing. You know, we called the Coast Guards. We learned so much. We called the Coast Guards. We did a whole distress call over VHF. The Coast Guards came in a massive boat, like a huge operation. We became famous in the town. Everybody in town was like, you guys are the guys, can we take a picture? Like, because it was pretty close to the shore. So the hotel we even stayed in that night was like, oh my God, you guys are the guys that were stuck out there. And the RNLI, okay, the Royal, whatever it stands for, it's the life boats, comes out with 10 people and they're doing all the stuff and they had to, and they saved us. Well, the thing is this though, is like, I was really chill about it in that, like, we were both pretty chill about it. Like, okay, like, look, just throw us a line, we'll pull the anchor up. And they're like, no, sir, you don't have to do anything, we got this. And the boat backs up and the guy's dressed in all orange, he looks like a real man, and we're looking like little wet poodles on the boat. Anyways, we end up getting anchored back into Great Yarmouth. No, it was more like, oh my God, why are we doing this? It wasn't so much, oh my God, we can't do this. Like, why do human beings do this to themselves? Like, why do we insist on you know? And I'm sure a lot of viewers will be like, well, not all of us do this, so, you know. but there is something super basic about the human being that you want to challenge yourself. You want to see what's possible. You want to go beyond the norm. But the beauty about it, and during that 100 hours of row, it is every person we've spoken to has said that the conditions that we experienced are pretty extreme. Not necessarily the most extreme we may experience during our trip, but they're up there. So that's good. That's good that we got to see a breakdown in technology, a breakdown in our bodies, a breakdown in weather, a breakdown in every single aspect, you know, was tested. And now that I'm sort of finished with it, I feel like I don't understand how any of the teams are not doing like these long things. Like, that scares me actually. Like 72 hours and that's it. I think we're already like at a couple hundred hours and we still have so much to learn.